I went to the thrift store last night, as I often do, and to my surprise, they had a bumper crop of old computer parts there. Unfortunately, a lot of it was stuff I already have plenty of, like AT mini tower cases, 486 and Pentium motherboards, and ISA VGA cards, and modem cards, and 3.5-inch floppy drives, and things like that. But amongst the bagged parts they had on the shelf, I found some more interesting things. So these are the two bags I got for $3.99 each. And let's go through what's in them. I got this first one because it has several long ISA boards in them. And I kind of peeked at it and I saw that there's probably a CGA card in here. And the other thing looks like maybe an EGA card. So let's see what's in this one. Fortunately, these are not static-free bags, but I don't think these parts will be damaged by that. Made in Taiwan, it's the only thing I see. MG, and it looks like a serial number, so maybe a Hercules monochrome graphics card. That's a 6845 chip, which is the video controller, and there you can see there's the video RAM here. So I'm thinking this is probably a aftermarket Hercules MDA monochrome graphics and printer port board. It's always good to have one of these around. A little bit of dust on it, but it looks like it's in good condition. Absolutely no manufacturer name on it or part number, just that sticker and a quality control OK sticker. Just says made in Taiwan. So it's one of these very generic Taiwanese PC components. I think the Taiwanese government heavily invested in their computer industry, and for a while in the late 80s the computer market was pretty much flooded with Taiwanese motherboards and expansion boards like this. But it's nice to have one of these anyway. And this one I'm thinking is an EGA card because it has the two RCA jacks, which are not composite video outputs. These were called feature connectors, and they were designed for things that were never really used. You can also see the dip switches there for changing the settings, and it has the pinouts for adding more RAM, and has an IBM copyright, so I believe this is an IBM EGA card. I'll have to look it up online and see if it matches exactly. 1501529. Looks like the part number on that one. Unfortunately, it does not have the extra memory, so this would not be able to show all the better EGA graphics modes, because I think these came with 64K video RAM and were expandable to 256K, I think. Copyright 1984 IBM, so it definitely looks like an IBM EGA card. There's one more card in here. This is a sound card, and FCC ID is IXW-MVI-PAS-2S. So this is a Pro Audio Spectrum card, which was one of the big competitors to the Sound Blaster in the early 90s. Not sure exactly what model this is, but it's a 16-bit card. NT9302, so it looks like it's from 1993. Although the date on the circuit board is 9221, so either 92 or 93. It has a MediaVision MVD101 chip, also dated 1992. Another MediaVision chip here. It has an internal speaker connector, so maybe you can pass through your PC speaker output and mix it together with the sound card output. And it looks like a CD-ROM port there, of Zilog controller. I think that's Zilog. It's SCSI, so that's a SCSI CD-ROM controller built in. And it has built-in amplifiers for the speaker outputs, which is something you don't see in sound cards these days. There's the address jumper, 220, 230, or 240. 220 was the default, also used by Sound Blaster. I don't know if this was compatible with Sound Blaster. I think it was Adlib compatible, but not necessarily Sound Blaster compatible. But a lot of games from the early 90s supported the Pro Audio Spectrum, so compatibility was not really a big problem with this. It has some voltage regulators here. LM7905, that will be the 5 volt regulator, and 7805. So maybe plus and minus 5 volts, more jumpers there. Probably you can set the outputs to your speaker level or line level. And it has microphone input, output, and input jack, so it does have a line input, and a joystick port which can also be used for MIDI, I'm sure. Assembled in Singapore. 650-0014, copyright 1992. So that's a Pro Audio Spectrum sound card. Here's the second bag. And I think you can see already, it has a 5 1/4 inch floppy drive in it. I have a couple of these already, but it's nice to get these when you can find them, because they're getting hard to find. There's a couple gashes in that cover there, but I can knock those out and make it flat again if that's a problem. Has the drive mounting rails already attached to it, so they must have removed it from a case. And that faceplate is a little misaligned. In fact, it's a little bit loose. So this might have been bashed and banged around a little bit, but I think it should still work. It's a Matsushita, so it's a Panasonic drive. Probably 1.2 megabytes. Yeah, it says Panasonic on it. JU-475-3AK. 8950, so it's probably 1989. There's the drive head mechanism. I grabbed a 5 1/4 inch disc just to see if it goes in properly. Yep. Squeaky, I don't know if you can hear that on video. Oh, that's actually the... thought I heard something rattling around inside there. But you can see when I move the flywheel with my finger, you can see the thing in there moving, if we get the camera angle right. So, good to have a 5 1/4 inch floppy drive. Getting hard to find these days. And here is a Quantum Bigfoot 5 1/4 inch hard drive. Now I'll need to get a 3 1/2 inch drive to give you the size comparison, but you can see Bigfoot CY, made in Singapore, 5.25 series, 2111AT. Don't see a date on it, unless that's a date code. 0800 will be the year 2000, which is pretty much what I would expect. Although, only 2.1 gigabytes by 2000, that was already quite small of a drive, because my dad bought a compact Presario in early 1999, and it had, I believe, a 4 or 5 gigabyte hard drive. I have a video about it on my channel that I did years ago. I'll have to go back and check exactly how big of a hard drive it has. But that came with a 3 1/2 inch Seagate hard drive, which was surprising because Compaq, as you can see from this sticker here, was one of the biggest users of these 5 1/4 inch Quantum Bigfoot hard drives. And they put these into a lot of their Presario consumer range of PCs back in the late 90s. So a little bit surprising, his came with a 3 1/2 inch Seagate hard drive instead of one of these. It even says Compaq Computer Corporation, so this is before they got bought out by HP. There's a Lucent chip on it. 9737, so it's 1997, which is closer to what I would expect from one of these. Has some kind of mounting bracket already installed on it. A little bit of rust on it. That one says 2160AT. Well, that says 2111AT. Replace with Compaq Spare 2.1HD, so it's 2.1 gigabyte. For size comparison, there's a 3 1/2 inch hard drive compared to the 5 1/4 inch Bigfoot. And the reasoning for bringing these out was that hard drive sizes were rapidly increasing in the late 90s, and the two ways to make a hard drive bigger capacity is to either increase the density of the magnetic recording on the drive platters, which is what most companies did, but that's kind of expensive to develop that. The easier way is just make the drive platters bigger. So they brought out these 5 1/4 inch Bigfoot hard drives. And I can kind of see the reasoning for it, because by the late 90s, nobody was really using 5 1/4 inch floppy drives anymore, even though ironically this one was bagged together with a 5 1/4 inch floppy drive. But most people were no longer putting these into their computers, so they had an empty 5 1/4 inch drive bay, which would be the perfect place to put one of these hard drives in. I took off that mounting bracket, and here's one thing interesting I saw. It has a sticker here, and you can see right into the drive through that sticker. I don't know if I can get the right angle on my camera light. There you can kind of see it. You can see the drive platter through that clear sticker, so that's the only thing sealing in the drive from the outside air. And hard drives have to be sealed, because any kind of dust or contamination that gets in there could cause the heads to crash. So the only thing keeping this drive sealed is this little plastic sticker. But I guess if you've got this thing running, you can see the drive heads going back and forth through that little sticker there. So let's see if this thing works. I have one of these things that lets you connect any IDE or SATA hard drive to USB. These are very handy things to have. And also came with this little power supply to power the drive. So let's plug it in and see if it spins up. That's a good sign. I can hear it bonking, and then it spun down again, and that little light is staying on. Oh, now it's flashing. May have a dead drive here. These older quantum Bigfoots were known for problems. They were very unreliable. The later ones are fine, but the older ones, like this 2.1 gigabyte, were quite troublesome. So let me try again. I don't think this would make a difference, but I'll put it flat this time. Now it did the same thing. I could hear the heads going back and forth, and it just spun down again. So let's see if you can see anything through that window when I power it on. You can actually see the heads going back and forth. Yeah, that's definitely not a good sign when it tries to do a seek test and then it just shuts down again. I plugged it into the USB thing just to see if it recognizes anything on the computer. It recognized the USB thing, but I don't know if it recognized the hard drive. Well, this time now it's staying running. It's not shutting down again. But Windows is not recognizing the drive. So now that it's staying running, let me pull out the vintage computer and see if I can get it working with that. So I pulled out my Compact Despro EN. These are lovely little machines. And I plugged in that hard drive. Now, since this is a small form factor case, the hard drive wouldn't actually fit in it unless I took out the optical drive. But for testing, it's perfectly fine. I plugged in my IBM Model M2 buckling spring mechanical keyboard. Well, it turns out that IBM Model M2 keyboard wasn't letting this thing even power on. Wasn't even getting to post with it plugged in. So that probably has bad capacitors like those keyboards are known for. So in its place, I substituted this NMB, the Right Touch. Sounds fancy, doesn't it? Well, it's just regular rubber dome keys. But for a rubber dome keyboard, this has a pretty nice feel to it. So definitely not a bad keyboard to use. So let's see what happens this time. It's making that bonging sound again, so I don't know if it's going to work this time. But it's staying on, at least. That's just a SATA controller, so it's normal for that not to indicate anything. But it says no IDE fixed disk present. So that's not promising. And it's not recognizing the hard drive. It just shows the CD-ROM drive and the disk drive. It's actually a DVD burner. So let me try powering it down. And turning it back on. Yeah, that drive doesn't sound healthy. So, yeah, now it's shutting down again. So this very likely could be a dead drive. Unfortunately, kind of common with these older Bigfoot drives. The later ones are fine. I have a 12 gigabyte one in my custom-made Cyrix 6x86 computer, which I did a video about a couple years ago. That one has worked perfectly fine. Absolutely no problems with that. But the older Bigfoot drives were known to be problematic. You can see the indicator flashing an error code. Plug back in the Seagate hard drive that this thing had in it. It's one of these 120 gigabyte Barracuda 7200 RPM IDE drives. And these were one of the first fluid bearing hard drives. And that was a godsend back in the day because you no longer had to deal with that whining spindle motor noise like you heard with this one. It was the first time hard drives were nearly silent in operation. Here you can see Pentium 3, 996 MHz, so it's a 1 GHz CPU, and 512 megs of RAM, which is the maximum you can put in one of these. And I need to redo the thermal grease on that CPU cooler, because you can hear it speeding up the fan, and it's not supposed to be doing that. And this thing even has wireless on it. So, even though I don't have anything in this except Internet Explorer 8, we can actually go online. I've heard that Internet Explorer 8 actually still works on YouTube if you just hit no thanks. Yeah, it works enough for showing the ads. That CPU fan is really racing now. These things can get quite loud when they go at full speed. I'm trying to play a video about a Compact Despro EN, but so far just showing a black screen there. No, I don't know if that's going to work. I don't know if I have Flash Player installed on this thing. And I don't think it's powerful enough to use the HTML5 player. Well, here's one website which always works on old computers. amstereo.org. And it's kind of ironic when a Windows XP computer with no antivirus installed and Internet Explorer 8 is telling us that it's protecting our security. Yeah, I don't think this is a very secure computer to use, even though I do still use Windows XP online every day. I do have antivirus installed and running when I do that.